So we've got three of our speakers lined up as well. All right, so meanwhile, I'd like to also invite our next set of speakers on the stage. Another interesting panel discussion awaits us. We have with us our session moderator, Mr. Akhtar Chauhan, who's the director of Rizvi College of Architecture. May I please invite him on the stage as well? And can we have a round of applause to welcome Mr. Akhtar Chauhan? Well, joining him, may I please invite Dr. Amita, Professor and Dean, School of Habitat Studies with Tata Institute of Social Sciences. And further, may I please invite Professor Deborrah Stone. Warm round of applause there. We have three of our final set of speakers indeed for another interesting panel discussion. And meanwhile, let's get the session started as well. And I'm going to request Mr. Chauhan to take it over from here.
Welcome to this concluding session of the evening. We are going to deal with very important issue of managing land, which is a very critical resource, and also engaging the youth in the process of sustainable development of our habitat. We have with us two very distinguished professionals with us, Dr. Amita Bhide. She is the Professor and Dean of School of Habitat Studies at Tata Institute of Social Sciences. And she teaches courses linked to housing at the Institute for over 8 years. She has actively researched housing policies, including programs such as slum rehabilitation schemes in Mumbai, and engaged in policy-level inputs linked to pro-poor housing, real estate regulations through task forces of state government. In recent years, she has been engaged with this also. And her research has extended to study of housing issues and affordable housing in particular in small and medium scale towns of Maharashtra. She also contributes to Pan-India Civil Society Networks linked to housing. And her recent publications include The Regularizing State and Comparing Informalities. So we welcome Dr. Amita Bhide to this panel discussion. We also have with us Deborrah Stone. She has been the Chief Sustainability Officer and Director of Department of Environmental Control, Cook County, Illinois. She became country's first Sustainability Officer in 2011, and she's also Director of the Cook County Department of Environmental Control, which regulates air emission and solid waste facilities and works with local communities to clean up and redevelop brownfields. The projects she is engaged with include an award-winning ordinance fostering recycling, reuse of building demolition debris, and fostering community solar energy in the region. Cook County is well ahead of target in reaching 80% of GHG reduction by 2050. As Deputy Director of Illinois Department of Natural Resources, she oversaw the state's first water supply planning and spearheaded Conservation Congress, working in partnership with hundreds of recreation and natural resources constituent groups. She has an MA in public policy from the University of Chicago. We welcome her, Deborah, to this panel discussion. Just to open this discussion, I would like to say a few words. Land has become the most important and critical resource in urban development, and particularly in countries like India and many of the Southeast Asian countries, where there's tremendous population pressure on our land. Managing this in a changing economic scenario with liberalized economy, one has to reinvent the state and local level policies of managing land. We are concerned with providing shelter to our people, and as you all know, Mumbai has a very difficult situation with more than 60% people living in slums. The issue of affordable housing becomes a key issue in our state policy. The recent initiatives at the center and the state level with government scheme focusing on affordable housing is most welcome. And in this context, there is a lot of expectation from the government and people expect that this policy will be translated into actions and one would see the changing scenario. So with this opening remarks, I would request Dr. Bhide to make her presentation.
Thanks, first of all, perhaps both to Economic Times as well as the organizers of this forum. In talking about affordable housing, land, and actually the academics of it, right, which is what I've been asked to talk about, there are just four or five major points that I would make, like to make. And one of the first is perhaps to remember that in India, one is simultaneously seeing multiple kinds of approaches to land. And these range even now from those kind of regimes which do not relate to land as property at all, but link and relate to land much more in terms of usufructory uses. Okay? So, which means that you don't think about inheritance, you don't think about ownership, you basically approach land for livelihoods and perhaps then leave it for others to also make simultaneously their claims over land. So this is a regime which exists even now among several tribal peasant societies in India. I would say that there is a second kind of regime which links to land. And that regime is one which is trying to make claims over land, again through a non-legal or perhaps extra-legal kind of a mode. Okay? This again we see in the form of perhaps slums. This we see in the form of vendors. Okay? So there are multiple such forms of property which exist. And we have a third kind of a regime which is coming through more legal kind of manners where ownership is something which is being talked about, but in a more incomplete manner. In between all of this, there is also an entire regime which looks at appropriation of land. And I think appropriation of land, I want to put forth before you, is an equally important regime in India because often this uses informational networks which are present, which are very dense, very thick, and uses these information which is highly untransparent, which is closeted, wiggles that out. It depends on closely grounded kind of knowledges and then utilizes it for self-interest. Okay? So there are these four regimes minimally which are coexisting and which link to land. Linked to all of this now, when we begin to talk about affordable housing per se, okay, affordable housing in the country itself, and as a terminology, affordability is something which has again emerged very, very freshly. Because it has been housing per se has been viewed as a strategy. Housing is a strategy by which people make claims to different kinds of things which are available in cities, opportunities, resources, and within which housing plays a very important role. Affordable housing now represents a change within all of this. It, to my mind, represents at least three important kinds of change. One is that one is looking at housing as an end within itself. Okay? Rather than looking at housing as a strategy that we talked about, it looks upon housing as the goal of that several groups of people desire, want, and end up. Okay. Now, what are the implications it will have? Whether it has a significant leverage at all? For whom? All of these are questions which remain to be answered. The second important change that affordable housing seeks to make is in terms of the entire form of cities itself. How do you relate to land? Okay? And the form of cities in India has been an extremely dense one, extremely compact one. Today, when we in the context of sustainable development, when cities in the US, cities in many different countries of the North begin to seek a compact form, our cities, in fact, are extremely compact, extremely dense, okay? But on the other hand, they also have an extremely high environmental footprint because of the manners in which land and housing are being utilized and because of the lack of infrastructures. So that form of the city is sought to be changed through affordable housing. Okay? Because in talking about affordable housing, there are two kinds of strategies which are being pursued. A, that you go for verticalization of cities, and the second is you go for a more sprawl mode, the urban sprawl mode, okay, where you expand the boundaries of the city, you move out of the city in the name of finding affordable land, and then you construct housing there. Okay? And both of these are important challenges to the kind of urban form which has existed. It is a challenge in terms of thinking through what is the kind of infrastructure which is also demanded by these kind of changing urban form. And the third question which emerges is, keeping in mind all those four kinds of things that I talked about in terms of how people relate to land, the question is, the new logic, the new discourse in affordable housing in terms of land is, how do you utilize land in the most optimal manner? The subtext of that being, land, optimal utilization of land is the highest value of land going to the highest value user. So what is considered to be a low value use, what is considered to be a low value user, is something which is being pushed out of the thing and then being sought to be re-established in a place which is farther off, which is of less value. Now therefore, all of these four regimes are going to be impacted by this new discourse on land, right? So there are these changes. The third question before my mind is, now, how do we expose students? How do we train students in recognizing all of these nuances? There is one straight logic which is being fed, and which is, people need housing, there is a housing shortage, and in order to fulfill and meet that housing shortage, what you need to do is construct, construct, construct. Okay? But the minute one begins to analyze this, one begins to see that new construction only addresses one part of the housing shortage. A lot of our housing issues are to actually do that people have houses. It is the quality of that housing, it is the infrastructure linked to that housing which is actually an issue and which is a problem. Okay? So you need to train students in order to understand all of these nuances. And you have a brand of students increasingly, especially in urban India. There was a farmer leader in India, Sharad Joshi, who very, very famously said that within India, you have an India and you have a Bharat. India which talks and which is very, very connected to an external context, and a Bharat which is talking very much about agricultural India, poor India, farming India, rural India. Okay? And I think the student group that one increasingly gets is a group which is very much located in India, but which is not oriented to the Bharat. The challenge before all of us as academicians is to prepare students who can not only divide this and create a unity across the Bharat and the India, but to find that kind of feat in a discourse which speaks to all of these different regimes of relating to land, of finding that you will need to find solutions which are not displacing a particular set of people because they have no voice, because they have little resources to privilege, and whose knowledge does not count in many ways in the entire privileged world of either law or the economics of property. So when we will need to find a language where these people are also able to be accommodated. At the same time, one also needs to find a language of unity, because social sustainability, environmental sustainability is what will also sustain our cities. And therefore, what is that extension of the city, expansion of the city, which is reasonable, which is rational, but at the same time, which is not something which lends you into innumerable amounts of urban sprawl, where construction mania does not drive the entire discourse of affordable housing. And it is really within that challenge that we locate ourselves as a, I locate myself as an academician, as a researcher, as a teacher, someone who is engaged with young minds who are kind of constantly questioning. I don't find any easy answers here, but exposing students to all of these multiple regimes, multiple questions, okay, without necessarily, because I understand that government policy has often been like keeping your head in the sand, which refuses to look at realities around you, which has believed in unnecessary and irrational constrictions and constraints over construction. At the same time, one has also seen the entire developer community, the private sector, which has been in a, which has utilized some of these, I would say, selective informations in an extremely ruthless manner, where the profits have been so irrational. I mean, I think the profits that some of the construction industry has made are runaway profits, and they require a certain kind of pruning in order to also be sustainable. So I think it's actually trying to work with all of these stakeholders together in order to think about a more sustainable urban future within which affordable housing has a particular time and place. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhide, for that very comprehensive and very sensitive insight into this complex issue of managing land, working for providing affordable housing, and engaging youth through making them more sensitive and more socially concerned about this issue. So now I would request Deborrah to make her presentation. She has more practical and more deeper experience in managing the projects which deal with the issue of sustainability. So it would be wonderful listening to her.
Well, thank you so much. I think that was your very kind interpretation of learning that I am not an academic by trade, although I've been asked to speak about getting youth involved in land economics. I am a planner. I do most of my work in environmental issues, as you said, in water supply and air quality control and solar energy and other such things. So I do teach. I teach what I know. But I find that the students that I have at the college and graduate level, at least in America, they're already very well informed. You know, they have these things in their hands, and the world comes to them over their cell phones, over their computers, and they don't need me to transmit facts, to transmit content. They're also very eager. They're unbelievably productive. And they're very self-assured. I wish I had, at my age, the self-assurance of the young people that I see today. And they're passionate about sustainability. They're passionate about social justice. They want to make the world a better place. They're not just necessarily out to make money. So for these young people who have so far outstripped where I was at their age and already have all the facts of the world at their fingertip, I wonder sometimes what I could bring to them. And I find that the answer sometimes is that it is helpful to push them more towards critical thinking, which in my view means economic analysis of the world and that this is a set of tools that they don't necessarily have in their toolbox to accomplish with their great energy and their great passion the great goals that they have. And I do teach a class called Urban and Environmental Economics, and I invariably, on the first day of the class, a student will come and raise their hand and say, "You cannot put an economic value on the environment. Nature has unlimited value. The environment is sacred. You cannot discuss it in economic terms." And I say, "You know, you're right. It is sacred, and I believe it as you do, but not everybody does. And guess what? We put an economic value on the environment, on land, on nature all the time. By our actions, by our development policies, by our governmental budgets, by how we spend our personal time and dollars. And if you don't convince people about your opinion of the value of land and the value of nature, guess what? Somebody else is going to set that value, and you might not like it. So this is a set of tools for you to learn. The other way that I think it's important to give students and young people economic analysis tools is to think through what the economic incentives are of all of the actors that are involved in a problem. And students will come to me and they will say, "Well, we should recycle because it's the right thing to do." Or we should preserve all of the natural areas because it's the right thing to do. And I say, "Well, that's great, I believe the way you do, but how are you going to do that, and how do you know it's going to work? How do you know your policy is going to work?" And we have many famous examples in the United States of policies that were not thought through economically and did not meet the intended goal. One of them was the first institution of the CAFE standards, or the mileage standards on automobiles, and which were intended to reduce the amount of oil used, partly to make the United States more oil independent, but also for environmental reasons. So the government mandated that automobile manufacturers must increase the mileage per gallon of gasoline. Well, great. So if you are a car purchaser, if you are a driver, what do if you get more miles per gallon? You drive more, right? Because you have a certain disposable budget to spend on transportation. Or if you really like high-powered vehicles and you want to go fast, you drive, you buy a truck instead of a sedan because those were not regulated. So that was an example of not thinking through the economic incentives of all of the parties involved in a transaction. And so I try to bring the students along to say, "Hey, you really have to look at the environmental side. That is not just giving up. That's not just a crass interpretation. That's not just speaking the one language about land that says highest and best use. It's also a way to get other people to think about your values. Economics is neutral as to what your values are. It's a set of tools for how to deal with other people who have different values." I think the last thing I'll say is that I was very interested in the discussion about happiness that occurred. And it made me think a little bit about the students and the young people that I see, at least in the US. And I don't know if this is fair, but I believe they are more concerned about happiness than maybe some prior generations, even though my generation, the baby boomers, was considered very self-centered and very selfish. But they are very interested in their quality of life. They often will, and there's statistics and studies that will show this, they will move to a city that they want to live in, that has a good quality of life, that has a clean environment, that has a good public transport system, sometimes instead of taking a job with higher pay in a place that they don't want to live. They are very driven by finding meaning. They change jobs more often, and sometimes it's not just because they didn't get a monetary promotion, it's because they don't feel recognized or that their work is having an impact. And they're very impatient. They don't want to wait till somebody else blesses them with a degree or a certification or somebody else gives them a permission. They want to have an impact now. And I find a lot of hope for getting students involved in land economics and planning because of these characteristics that I see in youth.
Thank you, Deborrah, for that very crisp and very sharp note, bringing out the issues of sustainability and how the youth looks towards the quality of life in selecting their path in their careers. I would like to raise this issue of urban planning and regional planning. How do we manage land in an urban and regional context to ensure that we have adequate land for affordable housing? Dr. Bhide, would.
Okay, if we begin to look at urban and regional planning, I'll begin two steps back. Okay, one is in terms of thinking about how have we planned in the past and what are the current trends in planning and what is it that we need to do. So if we look back at the past, I think what we have done is largely our planning has been in the form of regulating land. Okay, and when I say regulating land, the overall logic which has been applied is that city growth has to be constrained. Big cities are bad, and therefore regional development becomes in some ways a counter to the growth of the big city. It in very, very small scale, we have also said that the growth therefore of satellite cities and satellite townships, which has been encouraged in the case of Mumbai, it has been encouraged in the case of Kolkata, partially in the case of Delhi, but in other cities, we have actually not succeeded in doing that at all. Okay, so this has largely been in terms of looking at land, housing. There are, whether this is all actually the objective of regional development, that remains to be answered totally. Like just giving the example of the Mumbai metropolitan region itself. The Mumbai metropolitan region consists of minimally 9 municipal corporations. There are several municipal councils and it has over 900 villages, gram panchayats. Okay. Now, whether those gram panchayats have benefited from the regional development plan, this is something which the metropolitan development plan doesn't even begin to address. Okay. So it is the city's vision of development, city's needs of housing, dumping, water, which are actually sought to be addressed in a regional context. Okay. And this is something which really exists in India. The second big issue has been that we state a vision, but in terms of the application of resources for that vision, has never been thought of at all. So if we start looking at what is the extent of the plan which has actually been implemented, now that begins to cut a very, very sorry tail. So even in the most executed metropolitan development plan, which is perhaps the case of Delhi, I think their maximum amount of resources has been deployed. And yet we see that issues such as housing are actually never addressed by the state at all. Not just that, but what we actually see is that the state becomes a party to speculation. So it is not just that private sector speculates, but it is also state that speculates. So we make land very, very expensive. We make housing very scarce. And in this way, we encourage the growth of slums, many, many informal developments, unauthorized housing, which has become like the characteristic of all our cities. So every formal development in India is accompanied by an equal, if not more, proportion of unauthorized housing. Just witness Navi Mumbai. You produce one formal planned development and it is accompanied by huge amounts of unauthorized housing in Digha, in Airoli, and in all other townships around Navi Mumbai. Okay? So this has been the characteristic of our planning. Now, where do we go back? I think what we have to recognize is that the scale of state action is very, very limited. We have to also recognize that the scale of what the private sector, the organized private sector can do is also limited. And there is a third actor which is very, very critical and which has been important in India, and which is the people themselves, the small contractors who are doing a bulk of the housing, a bulk of the construction themselves. So how do we make them into partners? Okay? How do we loosen the entire burden of construction? How do we loosen the entire burden of the formalities through which? So we always talk of developers in India who have to go through a permission regime. But we never talk of the permission regime which actually affects the common person. Okay? So how do we create partnerships with common people? And this, to my mind, will really change the form of planning, the nature of planning, the scale of planning that we do both at the city level as well as at the regional level. To me, it is not about planning now coming from the top, but it is actually how does this planning begin to reconcile the voice which comes from the bottom. And when the private sector, when the state begin to recognize these voices, that is where I think we will have a real match of interests.
Thank you for bringing up those issues of informal settlements and participation of people in managing their own housing and the need for change in the state and local policies. What would be your experience of urban planning ensuring a better quality of life, not only in the city but also in the periphery and the suburb?
So I see that the hourglass here is flashing red at me, so I will keep my remarks brief. But while Larry gave you a very rosy picture of planning in Chicago, going back to the Burnham Plan, which we still quote today, make no little plans, they have no magic to stir men's blood. But we have, I would say, fairly weak regional planning. We have many hundreds of local governments. Our tax and public revenue system relies heavily on property tax and sales tax, which of course are place-based. So we have a very fragmented governmental system with governments that have an incentive to attract development for themselves and no incentive to host affordable housing. And this is a problem that we cannot solve in our metropolitan region. It can only be solved at the state level. And I don't see that happening anytime soon. But one piece of hope that I do see, personally, I work for a county government, which is a mid-level government between the local municipalities, of which we have 130, city of Chicago and the rest are suburbs, in between that and the state. Before it was somewhat neglected form of government that was not much in the public eye. We operate the courts and the jail and the hospital, so you really only dealt with Cook County at parts of your life where you didn't want to interact with the government. You don't want to go to jail, you don't want to go to the hospital. But the poor population in the city of Chicago is more and more suburbanized. There are a number of reasons for that, but it's a reality. And de facto, the county has become an option to have a strong regional government. There is very little that we can do for affordable housing directly. We do funnel some federal funds in, but those are going to decrease, not increase. But one thing that we can do, relates again to a discussion this morning, is we can foster good planning that looks comprehensively at transportation, jobs, and housing, because it doesn't matter how much you subsidize or build housing. If people can't have incomes, their situation is not going to improve. And if they don't have good transport, they can't get to the jobs. And if you don't pull the jobs in closer to where they live, the transport is going to be unsustainable for them. So that is something that we can do, is look comprehensively at all those three factors.
Thank you so much. It brings us to this situation where the issue of sustainability cannot be ignored anymore. In a developed country, as well as in a developing countries and the countries which are in transition, this issue needs to be addressed in all sectors of our economy, not just for housing or not just for transportation, but in all sectors of our economy, at all levels, at the level of the city, at the level of the village, at the level of the region, at the level of the state and the country. There has been tremendous amount of innovation in these fields, and we need to absorb the results of this innovation to bring about the change that we require at our own level. Unfortunately, it takes a lot of time. There is a big gap between the innovation and by the time we adopt it for action. So at the level of governance, there is a need for greater transparency, and no longer it's just a slogan, but we need good governance at all levels to resolve these issues which have been staring at us for so many decades. The youth is in no mood to wait. They want change, and they want change for better quality of life. They want better opportunities in terms of their career choices, in terms of the kind of social infrastructure, in terms of better quality of education. So we are all duty bound, whether we are in public sector, whether we are in private sector, or whether we are with NGOs or the informal sector, whether we are in the industry or the business or in academics. All of us are charged with this social responsibility to address these issues in a very near future. Otherwise, we'll be facing some catastrophe. We need to avoid that through planning, through strategizing our development approaches, and by delivering it through good governance. With this, I thank my colleagues, Dr. Bhide and Deborah, for this wonderful little discussion on managing land, providing affordable housing, addressing sustainable issues, and engaging youth. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. If I may please invite Dr. Sukesh Jamwar, the CEO of Buldana Urban Credit Cooperative Society India, to please come on stage and present the mementos to our panel members. Thank you once again. With that, ladies and gentlemen, we come to the end of all these invigorating discussions as well as deliberations from our speakers. But then, as they say, it's not over until it's over. We're going to be taking a quick 25-minute break for tea, coffee, and we're going to be back again for another very, very interesting segment of the evening. So stay tuned, and we'll see you all in about 20 minutes. We'll get started with our next set of felicitation ceremony in about 20 minutes.